Kalorama, a Recorded Books High Bridge imprint, presents Western Jihadism by Jytte Klausen, read by Rosemary Benson. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures, photos, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. 15 years ago, in a book also published by Oxford University Press, I challenged the Clash of Civilizations thesis promoted by Samuel P. Huntington, a Harvard professor, who argued that Muslims in the West are an indigestible minority, made incapable of integrating into a liberal democracy by their observance of religious law that precludes loyalty to a secular constitution. My research had demonstrated that, in fact, European Muslim civic leaders and elected politicians unequivocally supported the norms of democratic governance. A few reviewers complained that I had ignored the obvious. Self-evidently, Islamists had declared war on the West in the name of Islam. Why did I write only about the good Muslims? Oddly, around the same time that the culture war over Islam in the West was building, government officials across Europe and in the United States were not particularly troubled by Islamist extremism. It did not represent an obvious, immediate challenge to domestic security. Osama bin Laden was in hiding. There had been no serious terrorist attacks in the West since the suicide bombings of the London Underground in 2005. Al-Qaeda seemed beaten. I thought both camps had it wrong. The resurgence of this violent, apocalyptic fringe movement has little to do with religion, or how Muslims living in Western democracies feel or think about their lives. Western Muslims are not generally alienated from the broader society. Al-Qaeda would never recruit more than a tiny minority of Western citizens to its service. However, the global jihadist movement that Osama bin Laden spearheaded continues to pose a danger to the domestic security of Western democracies and to the political and economic stability of countries with large Muslim populations in Africa and Asia. The problem was that we just did not have good data for understanding the mechanics of how a global transnational terrorist organization was able to mobilize and grow on the scale that Al-Qaeda and its affiliates have been able to do. Therefore, in 2006, working with my students, I began to collect the data needed to get an evidence-based understanding of how Al-Qaeda took hold in Western democracies. This book describes the results of my data-gathering project and presents a novel picture of how Western jihadism developed. Riding a wave of globalization and mass migration, it was at once global and local, religious and political, fundamentalist in ideology, postmodern in its practice. And it is still there, stronger than ever. 1. Introduction. Al-Qaeda, the world's most dangerous terrorist organization, was founded in August 1988 at a meeting that Osama bin Laden convened in his house in Peshawar, Pakistan. Al-Qaeda did not start in Saudi Arabia, as is often thought. He wanted to create a rapid deployment force of experienced fighters for the armed jihad, to be commanded by himself and a small cadre of veteran jihadist revolutionaries. The movement that bin Laden initiated in his sitting room, in exile, ballooned into a global movement of political cadres, public intellectuals and street preachers, military fighter brigades, and webmasters waging online jihad. Decades later, the movement that bin Laden started is operating on 5 continents and includes an estimated 100,000 armed fighters in Asia and Africa. The number is based on reporting by the analytical support team of the United Nations Security Council's ISIL, Daesh, and Al-Qaeda Sanctions Committee, and analyses by independent researchers. A report from 2018 by the Center for Strategic and International Studies estimated the number of active al-Qaeda-aligned fighters to be closer to 250,000, 270% higher than in 2001 at the time of the 9/11 attacks. No one really knows precisely how many there are. This book is about the Western branch organizations in this global movement. Western democracies have been the target and, paradoxically, home base, sometimes a sanctuary, for the global jihadist movement. Jihadism is fueled by a revulsion against the values and objectives that sustain global growth and openness. Nevertheless, the movement thrives on globalization. Nationalists mourn the erosion of borders caused by globalization. The jihadists see it as an opportunity. They fight not for control of a patch of land. They fight against the system of states. Al-Qaeda and the jihadist movement, broadly defined as the networks and organizations, supporters and propagandists aligned with Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State, is not, of course, only, or even primarily, a Western phenomenon. In the 1990s, Osama bin Laden developed the doctrine of attacking the far enemy, the United States and its Western allies, on the assumption that relentless terrorism against American and Western targets would compel the United States to withdraw support from governments in the Muslim world. The strategy anticipates that, in consequence, the near enemy, the political classes in Muslim-majority countries, will be left vulnerable to the religious revolution that the jihadists see as the first step to the creation of a universal reign under God's law. It is a fantastical belief system. However, it is no more fantastical than revolutionary Marxism, which envisioned a stateless world to be brought into being by the awakening of the global proletariat, and which attracted followers across the world for 150 years. That people hold to fanatical ideologies is not what needs to be explained. The puzzle is how a belief system that kills off its followers at a high rate and is violently inimical not just to Western democracy but to all existing forms of Muslim governments can attract followers among Western Muslims and converts to Islam. The argument of this book is that the diffusion of jihadist extremism in Western democracies was driven by the strategic objectives of Osama bin Laden and the global movement he spearheaded, rather than, as is often argued, by local grievances of Western Muslims. I use the word movement to describe the global jihadist organization, but it is in fact more than a social movement. Social movements usually are seen as leaderless, fuzzy communities held together by shared ideas. The global jihadist movement is also held together by ideas, but the global organization has hierarchies and authority structures that create a hard core of control and command. It is these clandestine command structures that make it possible for the global movement to engage in coordinated insurgencies and manage terrorist campaigns across continents, and to do so in the pursuit of a unified strategic project. An apt term for this sort of very contemporary local global phenomenon is glocal, which the sociologist Anthony Giddens once defined as intensification of worldwide social relations, which link distant localities in such a way that local happenings are shaped by events occurring many miles away and vice versa. More prosaically, glocalization also refers to the adaptation of international products to the local context in which they are sold. Two observations may be made. The first is that glocalization creates infrastructures for risk management and risk avoidance, and for the allocation of resources, labor, and revenues. The transnational jihadist networks manage all that very efficiently. The other observation is that power in the global corporation rests not with the local hubs, but with the global management. Bin Laden, a Saudi millionaire, began his revolutionary career in alliance with Egyptian and Arab Islamist militants. In founding Al-Qaeda, his intention was to create a vanguard organization that would topple apostate Muslim regimes. But while the jihadists are utopians, they are also very practical revolutionaries. The extremist networks thrive on the transformations associated with globalization: increased openness of societies, cheap travel, and the ease with which ideas and influences can be disseminated from one region of the globe to another. Western societies provided them with opportunities to broadcast their views, to recruit supporters, to organize, and to move people and money around the world. Without this Western infrastructure, Bin Laden's project would have fallen apart at an early stage. The jihadist movement is globalist in aspiration and transnational in practice. In the 1990s, Western hubs of displaced North African and Middle Eastern extremist Islamists became absorbed into the global jihadist movement. Al-Qaeda established bases in North America, Europe, and Australia. Over time, as they adapted to local conditions, these Western hubs and networks developed their own styles and vernaculars. But always, their primary purpose was to recruit for the global movement. Western militants are fitted into the global organization. What they do and how they do it is determined by the boss's business plan. Growth came at the cost of a certain loss of control, a familiar problem for any business. Bin Laden's project is, nevertheless, on its own terms, a success story. The data used here come from the Western Jihadism Project, a research program I started in 2006 and have continued without interruption since then. The project identified Western residents and citizens who have committed terrorism-related crimes, or who died while engaged in an attack, or while fighting in an insurgency in the name of Al-Qaeda, or any of the many groups and organizations aligned with Al-Qaeda and committed to the global armed jihad. The database includes demographic and biographical information about the thousands of men, 5,832 to be precise, and 561 women, who meet the inclusion criteria. We record their contacts with other identified terrorists and document conspiracies committed by the networks. 20 countries are represented in the database. The methods used for collecting the data are described in the appendix. The network map on the cover of this book depicts 30 years of networking by Western jihadists and their bosses in the global jihadist movement. The network lines resemble familiar maps stashed in the pockets of seats on board planes, showing the airline's route net traversing the earth. Here, they represent communications between Western militants and their opposite numbers in the network. The map shows the travel from their hometowns in the pursuit of terrorism-related activities, and it charts their communications with other actors in terrorist networks. Each dot and line reflects a data point derived from public information gathered by my teams of student researchers and manually entered into a digitally managed database. It took 15 years and the work of 80 students. Analytically, the militants and their organizations are treated as a connecting point in the network, nodes. The dots pinned on the map mark the militants' residencies and geographical locations in which they engaged in terrorist activities or the location of their contacts. Each line, edge, between the nodes in the network represents communications for purposes of conspiracy, acts of terrorism, and other actions or communications associated with terrorism-related crimes revealed in public records. A total of 44,500 edges, representing links between the actors and entities, were used in the generation of the network graphic. The cover graphic vividly illustrates how Western-based militants integrated with the global jihadist movement and connected with its training camps in Afghanistan and Pakistan, and with jihadist insurgencies from Somalia to Syria. The dense mass of connected dots linking the nodes in North America, Western Europe, and Australia provides a summary visual representation of the transnational social organization of Western jihadism uncovered by the research project. The map shows how widely dispersed the cells, organizations, and individuals are across the Western world, from Alaska and the U.S. West Coast to Asia and on to Australia, and how closely they are interrelated. It may be assumed that the map captures just the visible tip of the metaphorical iceberg. Those depicted here are only the publicly known networked communications that we have been able to document from the public records available to us through court documents and media reports. Whatever lies below, we do not and cannot know. Al-Qaeda in the 1990s was like a startup. It failed and then failed again. But it had a formula for starting up once more. Operating both in jihadist heartlands and in the West, the movement has spread through a process that I will describe as networked contagion. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, a cadre of North African and Arab Islamist militants escaped to Europe and North America following failed attempts at revolution at home. From their bases in New York, London, Milan, Madrid, and a handful of other cities, they helped Osama bin Laden staff al-Qaeda and provided logistical support and manpower so that bin Laden could strike at the West. The bold attack on the United States on September 11, 2001, was a crowning achievement for bin Laden's organization. Bin Laden was not a theorist of revolution or a religious scholar. He was a political entrepreneur. His singular accomplishment was to give extremist Islamism a new strategic direction by focusing on a war against the far enemy, the United States and its Western allies. Global terrorism was the tactic. But for that, he needed Western adherents who could man clandestine transnational networks and use their passports to travel far and wide. His special talent was the ability to translate theory into action. He saw early on that new communications technologies made it possible for his organization to coordinate globally and exploit gaps in surveillance. For many years, few people in the West understood the true nature of the extremist Islamist ideology that motivated many jihadist refugees. In any case, it was assumed that they would do as most exiled expatriates do: blend in, be grateful for having been granted refuge, and direct their anger against their home countries. There were well-trodden pathways of migration from former colonies to the metropolitan centers of the former colonial powers and to New York City, a favorite destination for generations of migrants. Generous rules for granting residency to political refugees and persecuted religious groups from the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc countries had been passed in the 1980s. These opened the doors also to religious dissidents from authoritarian Muslim countries. The first generation of jihadist refugees included some men who became leading figures in the jihad against the West. Omar Abdel Rahman, an Egyptian cleric known as the Blind Sheikh, led the cell responsible for the 1993 World Trade Center from a perch in Brooklyn. Abu Ghatada al-Filistini, meaning the Palestinian, whose real name is Omar Mahmoud Muhammad, lived in London for 2 decades, where he built up a formidable local network and was a nuisance to British authorities until he was deported to Jordan in 2013. Abu Dada, alias Imad Edin Barakat Yarkas, a Syrian-born militant, ran an al-Qaeda cell in Spain and provided logistical support for the 9/11 hijackers. All were beneficiaries of new rules for granting residency to political refugees and persecuted religious groups. Using their new passports, the militants plotted and organized, and they created a cosmopolitan and global network. The jihadists thrived on the opening of borders that followed the end of the Cold War. Operatives who had fled or been expelled from their home countries were free to live the lives of post-national cosmopolitans and to build transnational networks. But the encounter with the West challenged their norms and values and led them to adopt new ways of doing jihad. At first, they operated mainly in mosques and prayer rooms. But their message soon spread more widely when the propagandists spoke the local languages, French, German, and always English, which is the common language among polyglot youths. A cadre of extremist public intellectuals articulated the doctrines to fit the needs of the new audiences. They uploaded long sermons on the internet, sold compact discs online, and marketed their tracts in bookstores. Gradually, the preaching incorporated local grievances. As they established a presence online, they reached audiences that were not confined to meeting halls and prayer rooms. None of this was criminal at the time, and many aspects of these activities are still not criminalized because they are, in essence, the sort of things that many legitimate political and religious groups do: hold meetings, spread the word, and proselytize. Jihadist intellectuals modified their ideas in this encounter with the West, adapting and rejecting Western political ideas and styles of protest. They developed a remarkably consistent anti-liberal system of thought and populist rhetorical styles that appealed to new followers with little or no knowledge of Islam. The first time the Western bases rescued bin Laden's project was after he was thrown out of Sudan in 1996. The men who came to his rescue were expatriate militants who had fled the home countries in North Africa and the Middle East in the 1980s and 1990s, and who, over a few years, became integrated into networks under bin Laden's command. The second time the Western militants rescued bin Laden's project came after al-Qaeda's near-death experience in December 2001, following the American counterstrike in response to the September 11 attacks. Al-Qaeda's bases in Afghanistan were obliterated, the leadership cadre decimated or driven into exile. The internet, another Western invention, helped the movement grow back, changing the ways in which the terrorist networks organize their operations and recruit new followers. This time, the rescue took the form of what became known as homegrown terrorism. Some analysts interpreted the Arab Spring uprisings in 2011 that swept Arab countries with a demand for reform and democracy as a repudiation of al-Qaeda's agenda. Fawaz Gurjis, a professor at the London School of Economics, wrote that only a miracle will resuscitate a transnational jihad of the al-Qaeda variety. The Arab Spring represents a fundamental challenge to the very conditions that fuel extremist ideologies. In 2012, Peter Bergen, the author of several books on bin Laden and a commentator on CNN, declared that al-Qaeda had been defeated because of the Arab Spring. He compared al-Qaeda to Blockbuster, a video rental chain that went bust when movie watching went online. Skeptics countered that the pro-reform Arab Spring movement was fractured, and that in many places it was coming under the control of the better organized Islamist groups. Two veteran al-Qaeda observers, Bruce Hoffman and Rohan Gunaratna, were among the skeptics. Acknowledging that the first generation of al-Qaeda, the so-called core, may be in decline, al-Qaeda has succeeded in expanding its tentacles. Al-Qaeda's tactic, Gunaratna wrote, was to go along with the democratic movements in the short term and win over new recruits. They would then try to take over the local resistance. This is what happened. When the regimes collapsed in Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, and Yemen, the extremists found room to recruit new followers. In Syria and Iraq, civil wars opened doors for a jihadist revival. Democracy, it turned out, was not the antidote to extremism that it was supposed to be. Tunisia is an example of a successful transition from an authoritarian regime to a representative democratic republic after the 2011 Arab Spring Revolution. But as Aaron Zellin writes, Tunisians joined the Islamic State in unprecedented numbers and became one of its largest sources of foreign fighters. By 2012, Syria had become a destination for old and new militants committed to the jihadist program. The proximity to Europe made this war zone particularly attractive to a new generation of righteous fighters for the cause, and their would-be wives. The movement's European bases sprang into action again, recruiting and organizing volunteers to fight with al-Qaeda. Some militants opted rather for al-Qaeda's deviant offspring, the Islamic State of Iraq, and the Levant, referred to as Daesh, ISIL, or ISIS. ISIS renamed itself to the Islamic State, resulting in a profoundly confusing alphabet soup of acronyms. To be clear, the Islamic State is a terrorist organization and also refers to a pseudo-state that lasted for more or less 5 years. That state, in turn, was the base for the proclamation of a new caliphate, a fictional claim conjured up by the terrorist group to control all of the world's Muslims. Media organizations use ISIS, ISIL, and the Islamic State alternatingly to refer to the terrorist group. Many have stuck with ISIS as the label, even after the group changed its name. Here, ISIS is used when referring to the group, and Islamic State when referring to the territory it occupied. At its peak, the Islamic State controlled about 10 million people across northern Iraq and eastern Syria, comprising a territory the size of the United Kingdom. The Islamic State was the product of an invading army of crowdsourced foreign volunteers. In 2017, Army Lieutenant General Michael K. Nagata, the director of the National Counterterrorism Center's Directorate for Strategic Operational Planning, assessed that an estimate of 40,000 foreign terrorist fighters from at least 120 countries had been identified at that time as having joined the Islamic State. Nagata admitted the number was imprecise and added, "It is probably the most ethnically diverse, sociologically diverse, non-monolithic foreign fighter problem we have seen so far." It was also inarguably the largest foreign fighter challenge the world has seen in the modern age. Explaining jihadist terrorism in the West. Why do they do it? There is a large, sprawling literature on the root causes of terrorism and on al-Qaeda specifically. Academic specialists in security studies and terrorism studies, which are not the same fields, have, however, been curiously blind to the ways in which globalization made it possible for an effective non-state networked global organization to emerge, grow, and manage its operations. These global terrorist networks work differently from states, but may occupy the same stage. Security studies have focused on states as the effective actors in international relations and downplay the independent importance of international terrorist networks. In their view, terrorism only becomes significant when it finds a state sponsor. Martha Crenshaw perceptively pointed out in her book Explaining Terrorism, 2011, that international relations theorists have an ingrained state-centric bias. The bias has made international relations specialists dismiss the national security risk that a non-state actor may pose to domestic security as well as to global stability. It followed from the state-centric theories that terrorists will not be able to undermine a Western state, nor bring about a shift in the balance of power in the global system. Sociologically inspired approaches have their own blind spots. Rather than identifying state sponsors, terrorism studies specialized in bottom-up analyses of the root causes of terrorism and motivations, of which there are so many that they cannot easily be generalized. However, they tend to ignore the broader strategic thinking of a sophisticated global leadership. Law enforcement and intelligence agencies, too, have had trouble connecting the dots. The 9/11 Commission report found that the information needed to anticipate and assess the threat posed by bin Laden had been flagged and routinely put on the desks of successive presidents. The institutions responsible for the country's safety nevertheless failed to prevent the attacks because of four kinds of failures: an imagination, policy, capabilities, and management. The world of academia may also be faulted for a lack of imagination and for a failure to recognize the big picture. Broadly, three schools of thought, three and a half schools, if we include the argument that Islam itself is the root cause of the problem with Islamist extremism, have dominated the discussion of why Al-Qaeda decided to attack the far enemy, the United States and its Western allies. I will discuss them briefly in turn, and then sketch an alternative perspective. The first line of argument is what Max Abrams calls the strategic model of terrorism, which is associated with what is known as the realist school in international relations theory. This school of thought is particularly influential in security studies in American universities and in the foreign policy establishment. Realist theory takes it for granted, first, that states are the central actors in international politics, and second, that what states do is motivated by national interests. Expressions of moral concern or ideology are simply cloaks for self-interest. States may be resource-rich or resource-poor, but all compete for influence and control. Terrorism is accordingly understood as a tactic used in the competition between states to gain control of territory, of people, and of governance. In his book Dying to Win, 2005, Robert A. Pape argued that terrorism works. The title says it all. Suicide terrorists are a substitute for smart bombs. Strap a vest on somebody and point him or her in the right direction, the human wrapped in the bomb will get to the target. Terrorism is selected when it is the most efficient means to achieve an objective, and so is suicide terrorism. As for the suicide terrorist's own motivations, they are incidental to the strategic interests of the terrorist organization. There is nothing particularly religious about jihadist suicide terrorism. Many terrorist groups, aside from Al-Qaeda, have used suicide missions. Among them, groups that have no sympathy for Islamist conceptions of martyrdom. The realists can cite historical examples in support of their thesis. National liberation movements, from the African National Congress to the Palestine Liberation Organization and the Basque and Northern Irish separatists, used terrorism to ratchet up costs to the state, but were pacified by concessions and compromises. Al-Qaeda's campaign against the West, Pape writes, is mainly a response to foreign occupation rather than the product of Islamic fundamentalism. He insists it is wrong to assume that jihadist suicide terrorism is the product of an evil ideology. The ideology may be evil, but an evil ideology is not the cause of what the terrorists do. The jihadist terrorist campaign will continue as long as the United States has troops in Iraq and on the Arabian Peninsula. This makes the United States an occupying force, and therefore the target. Withdraw, let the locals handle the problem, Pape advised, and the attacks on the United States and the West will cease. Max Abrams, also coming from the realist school, argues that, on the contrary, terrorism does not work. It repels the people whose support the terrorists seek. And the more violent terrorists become, the less inclined governments will be to negotiate with them. The 9/11 attacks are an example. They hurt rather than helped al-Qaeda. After the 9/11 attacks, al-Qaeda's organization was decimated, and its leadership forced into exile. The strike was a disaster for the movement. According to Abrams, the Islamic State imploded from within because its caliphate depended on a reign of terror and therefore was not sustainable. So, what should Western governments do? Ignore the terrorists, Abrams counsels. Don't talk them up. Don't kill the leaders. That will only rouse the followers. Governments should engage with the terrorist leaders, but in private. Smart leaders will control their followers and limit the violence. Bad leaders will ratchet up the violence and so lose support. When militant leaders are stupid enough to broadcast their massacres, let's not stand in their way. The more violent, the less likely the group is to succeed. Abrams' final piece of advice is that governments should put his book into the hands of militant leaders. Following his rules will help them achieve their goals. Bin Laden had a surprisingly large collection of books written by American analysts and academics in his house in Abbottabad, Pakistan. He might have been interested. But would ignoring al-Qaeda persuade Ayman al-Zawahiri, the Egyptian physician and militant who became the leader of al-Qaeda after Bin Laden's death in 2011, to negotiate? There is no plausible scenario under which that is a likely outcome. In 20 years, al-Qaeda has not been able to stage another coup on the scale of the 9/11 attacks. International terrorism could be ignored as a risk to American domestic security, which, among some of the more isolationist thinkers in international relations, is all that matters, unless they have weapons of mass destruction, WMD, capable of causing mass civilian casualties. And it is unlikely that terrorist groups will get their hands on WMDs without the help of a state sponsor. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, the list of candidates for state sponsors of terrorism narrowed to Iran, Iraq, and North Korea. Rogue countries like these could, and should, be kept in check by the traditional means available to the United States as a superpower. Hawks in the Bush administration trumpeted a Saddam Hussein bin Laden axis of evil that justified the 2003 Iraq War. There was no such alliance, although the theoretical model insisted it just had to be there. Ironically, the architects of the 2003 invasion of Iraq, Dick Cheney, the vice president, Donald Rumsfeld, the secretary of defense, and Paul Wolfowitz, security advisor to George W. Bush, were all political scientists and adherents of realist theory. They drew the conclusion that, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, the United States was left standing as the hegemon in a unipolar world. Now it was up to the United States to set the rules. There was also the idea that in a unipolar world, spreading democracy by military force was in the long-term interest of the United States. Daniel Dewdney and John Eikenberry described the disagreement between interventionists and advocates of restraint as an intramural dispute among realists. This disagreement also does not overlap neatly with partisan political divisions. Democrats and Republicans alike are split between advocates of restraint, bordering on isolationism, and humanitarian interventionists accused of perpetuating an endless war on global terrorism. Realists who do not favor military intervention often advocate variants of what they call offshore balancing, foregoing direct military interventions and letting the locals handle local problems. Onshore deployment brings with it the risk that the United States will make itself responsible for situations that the country cannot and need not control. The wars in Afghanistan and Iraq are held up as prime examples. However, isolationism cannot put the genie of globalization back in the bottle. Can the United States simply turn away when humanitarian concerns demand intervention? From Cambodia's Pol Pot, to Serbian atrocities in Bosnia, and on to genocide in Rwanda and the Islamic State, the American response has been inconsistent. When human rights advocates argue for military intervention to prevent atrocities, realists are the skeptics at the table. When it comes to terrorism far away from American shores, realists of both camps agree that terrorism is a top-down problem. Modify how the leaders act, and so reduce the demand for terrorists. If the demand for terrorists goes away, the terrorists will also go away. Rather like Abrams, Audrey Cronin argues in How Terrorism Ends that states should start negotiating with leaders of terrorist groups, including al-Qaeda. It is a weak and divided organization, she writes, which has actually been strengthened by the overreaction of government agencies. Similar views may be found in the works of a number of political scientists, John Muller and Mark G. Stewart, Mark Sageman and Charles Kurtzman, to mention a few. But as Cronin acknowledges, al-Qaeda has outlived the statistical life expectancy of terrorist groups, and it has repeatedly made a comeback after predictions of its demise. The realist worldview suffers from an unrealistically narrow conceptualization of rational action. Terrorist groups base their strategies and actions on their own theories about this world and the next. The realists assume that the jihadists are either out to get their own patch of land or are proxies for states seeking to control territory. This misconstrues the aims of the jihadist movement. The jihadist worldview is anchored in an apocalyptic vision of an Islamic awakening that will sweep away all borders. With that comes a theory of history, and there follows, logically enough, a blueprint for action that relies on divine intervention. Al-Qaeda has failed many times, but has a capacity for recovery unparalleled among terrorist groups. Bin Laden fatally miscalculated how the United States would respond to the 9/11 attacks. The retaliation that followed caused huge damage to him personally and to his organization. But the realist school has consistently underestimated the resilience of Bin Laden's organization and of the jihadist networks. The state-centric focus of the realists blinds them to the true strengths of the jihadist movement. The jihadists are capable of adjusting tactics to the facts on the ground. They can be savvy and flexible exponents of realpolitik. But any accommodations or trade-offs they make are tactical. They will not compromise on the ultimate objective. Any concessions they make are temporary and can only be justified if they are in the interest of the long-term goal. This is to take back control of all territories once governed by Allah's law, the Sharia. The boundaries of the territory to be reclaimed are a matter of debate. The comparison of the jihadists to national liberation movements or ethno-national separatists who want their own state is therefore profoundly misleading. The jihadists have no homeland. They do not want a state for themselves. They want the end of all states. They see the weakening of Muslim states as a vehicle for uniting the imaginary global ummah, the borderless Muslim nation of righteous believers. They fight to speed up the process that leads inexorably to the return of the Messiah and the final day of judgment. Their ultimate goal is to hasten the coming of the apocalypse. Until that day comes, they will fight a global holy war. Their apocalyptic dreams may be fantastical, but their means are rational enough. Wait, wait, skeptics may say. Did the Islamic State not proclaim a state? They did, but they also declared a worldwide extraterritorial caliphate that was understood by followers as a springboard to global domination. Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State had differences about the state versus caliphate doctrine. Bin Laden allowed emirates, but not caliphates. The disagreement between Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State was partly a matter of theory. The faithful had to figure out which step on the escalator to the global jihadist revolution the Syrian civil war had landed on in late 2013, when the jihadists gained the upper hand among the rebel groups fighting the Assad regime. The Al-Qaeda view was that by wedding itself to a state, the Islamic State had neglected the duty to pursue a global revolution. The breakaway affiliate would be tied down in a fight for every piece of soil of which it had taken ownership. The Al-Qaeda bosses were right. In March 2019, after dragged-out trench warfare, the Islamic State lost control of the last slice of territory in eastern Syria and northern Iraq it had claimed for its caliphate 5 years previously. The jihadists are often depicted as violent thugs, but they are more than that. Their tactics and strategies are scripted by elaborate doctrines deduced by a militant intelligentsia. The Islamic State followed a theory for how to progress through the stages of the revolution to the end of history. The author of this theory was a jihadist intellectual who used the alias Abu Bakr Naji. Naji is allegedly a pseudonym for an Egyptian named Mohammed Hassan Khalil al-Hakim, who may have been killed in 2008. Naji's roadmap to the jihadist revolution was laid out in a document evocatively titled The Management of Savagery. The Arabic title is sometimes translated as The Management of Barbarism. The origins of the document are fuzzy. It was published online in 2004, but was probably written earlier. An English translation by William McCants, an American academic, was published online in 2006. The document surfaced years before the split between Al-Qaeda and its Iraqi branch, and its author is regarded as an Al-Qaeda-affiliated public intellectual. Al-Qaeda, too, is deeply wedded to a stage theory of the revolution, albeit not to Naji's timetable. Naji's plan lays out the phases of the revolution over a period of 20 years. The sixth and last phase, with the final battle between believers and non-believers, was supposed to arrive in 2020. Clearly, Armageddon is now past its due date. Taken literally, it isn't much of a plan. Nevertheless, it is worthwhile to pay attention to the logic behind it. The jihadists believe in the laws of history, and history is understood as a march through stages. Violence is more than a means to an end. It is the road leading to the apocalypse, when the Mahdi, the Messiah, will appear. A more prosaic explanation for the Islamic State's desire to establish a state is that the bosses needed the instruments of a state in order to plunder the locals. To realize that objective, they made an alliance with ex-Ba'athists, former members of Saddam Hussein's regime, who lost their jobs in 2003, when American officials in charge of Iraq's reconstruction decided to ban the party. Ba'athists are Sunnis, and they preferred an alliance with the Islamic State to submitting to the Shia government in Baghdad. Most did not share the globalist jihadist agenda. However, motivated, perhaps, by religious feelings, or by self-interest, or both, thousands of ex-Ba'athists converted to extremist Islam and joined the jihadist movement. Ex-Ba'athists formed their own fighter brigade, the Army of the Men of the Naqshbandi Order. It was declared a terrorist organization in September 2015 after it joined forces with ISIS. The collaboration between a terrorist group and a disgruntled and marginalized cadre belonging to an ethno-religious faction is a familiar scenario in the realist framework. According to the realist script, a diplomatic negotiation team should then step in. Theoretically, negotiations between the Iraqi government and the rebels to formalize some degree of self-governance and autonomy for the Sunni groups, short perhaps of a fully fledged state, but close enough to allow the factions their own turf. That is not what happened. Saddam-era officers ran three of the 23 ministries of government created by the Islamic State: security, military, and finance. But even so, there were problems. Within days, they took the revolution away from us, an ex-Ba'athist complained to journalists from Reuters in December 2015. He had helped the Islamic State take over Mosul in June 2014, a victory that was critical to the terrorist group's forward march. The Islamic State did not want a state, but not as much as they wanted to construct a global organization. In September 2014, fresh from significant conquests in Iraq and Syria, ISIS's spokesman, Abu Muhammad al-Adnani al-Shami, instructed soldiers of the Islamic State to conduct attacks against the West. Over the next 12 months, a wave of attacks took place in Europe and the United States, and against tourist targets in North Africa. All were credited to ISIS. In November 2015, a series of coordinated attacks in Paris carried out by French-Belgian militants who had returned to Europe on the instructions of Islamic State operatives killed 130 people and injured many hundreds. A second punch came in Brussels in March 2016, committed by the same network of Europeans returning from ISIS's insurgent state and managed by Frenchmen working for the ISIS high command. The attacks and the networks behind them are described in Chapter 11. A second school of thought on the roots of terrorism owes more to sociology than to political science. Sociologists often suggest an affinity between the Western jihadists and other, more conventional, bottom-up social movements. The term social movements connotes loosely organized and diffuse groupings and tendencies that lack formal organization and are held together by shared identity or by participation in a common campaign. People attracted to such movements are often thought to be driven by a sense of loss, or by outrage, or by fear. At least when applied to terrorism, there is a danger that this will turn into a circular argument. Only angry people use violence, therefore terrorists must be angry and alienated. Terrorism needs a sense of alienation from the status quo and a desire to change it, wrote Louise Richardson in the aftermath of the July 2005 attacks on the London Underground. Europe's Muslims were disenfranchised and disillusioned by the failure of integration. There are different versions of the argument, but broadly, it identifies social disadvantage and discrimination as the root causes of political violence and protest politics. A working group set up by the British government after the 2005 London Underground bombings endorsed the alienation thesis, declaring the root causes of terrorism are discrimination, deprivation, and alienation facing British Muslims. This focus on alienation leads to the idea that homegrown terrorism, violent acts committed in the name of Al-Qaeda, are manifestations of a spontaneous, leaderless, and bottom-up reaction to perceived injustice. Mark Sageman provocatively argued that Al-Qaeda does not exist as a coherent organization, except in the minds of counterterrorism officials. Western militants are a self-sufficient bunches of guys, he argued, and their relationship to Al-Qaeda is aspirational. They are motivated by anger and peer solidarity, and their organization has the characteristics of a leaderless social movement. In an odd twist, Al-Qaeda associates often allude to leaderless resistance. Adam Gadon, an American who became Al-Qaeda's chief press officer, exhorted Muslims not to wait for orders in a videotaped message. "My Muslim brothers, jihad is the personal duty of every able-bodied Muslim on the face of this earth until the last Muslim captive is freed and the last piece of occupied Islamic land is recovered, and until Muslims live in safety and security in the benevolent shadow of the Islamic State." Gadon's words would seem to support Sageman's argument that we are dealing here with a bottom-up movement. His rhetoric may also lend support to the idea that grievances motivate action. They may even bolster the realist argument that Al-Qaeda is at heart a resistance movement seeking national liberation. However, an obvious problem with that interpretation is that the concept of occupied Islamic land in Gadon's speech includes every Muslim state on the map, and also swathes of Europe and Africa that were once part of a larger Muslim empire. Recruitment tactics and religious rhetoric both inform the things that terrorists say. But what they say should not be confused with the motivations for their actions. In his Letter to America in 2002, bin Laden purported to explain why he had attacked the United States on September 11th. 2001. He recited a long list of grievances and demands, including the following: "Stop your oppression, lies, immorality, and debauchery that has spread among you. And it is saddening to tell you that you are the worst civilization witnessed by the history of mankind." Terrorist leaders cloak their motivations in the language of disaffection, but only for rhetorical purposes, to fire up their base and to reconcile sympathizers to their actions. Their true purposes are a different matter, driven by considerations of strategy and tactics. Don't pay too much attention to what the jihadists may answer when you ask why they hate the West. The realists are right on this point. Anger over Western immorality was not the real motive for the attacks on New York City and Washington, D.C. Bin Laden's pronouncements were propaganda directed to his hinterland. He was trying to restore his reputation with Muslim ultra-conservatives who thought he had gone too far. The reason bin Laden orchestrated the 9/11 attacks was that he assumed that the United States would then retreat from engagements in the Middle East, in the same way as the Reagan administration withdrew from Lebanon in 1984, after losing congressional support for the mission when Hezbollah, a Shia militant group, bombed the barracks in Beirut housing U.S. and French troops. The troops were there to prevent war between Israel and Palestinian forces backed by Arab countries. The other example of weak-kneed superpower responses that indelibly shaped bin Laden's strategy was the Soviet Union's withdrawal from Afghanistan in 1989, when the costs of propping up the local People's Front regime got too high. Bin Laden was convinced the jihadists caused the collapse of the Soviet Union, and that the United States was no different. It, too, would withdraw from the fight when the costs became too high. That Bin Laden's assessment was wrong hardly matters. The social alienation thesis is notoriously difficult to verify empirically. To the extent that any correlation can be established, it is rarely the most disadvantaged in society, but rather middle-class intellectuals or professionals who drive protest movements. That generalization applies also to the jihadist movement. In Why Men Rebel, 1970, Ted Gurr addressed the empirical observation that the social alienation argument has had little historical basis and modified the argument to speak instead of what he called relative deprivation, which refers to the experience of failure to achieve a standard of living to which an individual and a group think themselves entitled. Disappointed expectations, rather than poverty, fuel revolution. The poor already have low expectations, but intellectuals and the lower middle classes and professionals are the real revolutionaries. Olivier Roy, a French sociologist, updated the relative deprivation theory to fit the contemporary French situation. In a long essay published in Le Monde, France's premier intellectual newspaper, on November 25, 2015, just 2 weeks after the deadly attacks in Paris instigated by the Islamic State, Roy argued that people misinterpreted the jihadist movement. The headline said it all. Jihadism is a generational and nihilistic revolt. France's problem is with angry young Muslims, and this had nothing to do with the caliphate in Syria or with Islamic fundamentalism. The angry new generation isn't much interested in religion, he wrote. Its members know nothing about Islam. They do not become jihadist after a journey of religious radicalization. The current terrorist wave is not like the nationalist or neo-Marxist groups of the past. France is dealing not with the radicalization of Islam, but with the Islamization of radicalism. Young men from poor urban communities self-radicalize in peer groups, in their neighborhoods and on the streets. They bring along brothers and sisters. In the process, they turn against family and the local established Muslim community. The social profiles of the young men responsible for some of the major French terrorist incidents attributed to Al-Qaeda or its affiliates do fit the profile described by Roy. The Kouachi brothers, the shooters responsible for the attack in January 2015 on the satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo, were orphans who grew up in a Catholic orphanage. Their friend and fellow assassin, Amadi Koulibaly, was a French Malian who came from a secular background. These men did not grow up in Salafist enclaves. They encountered French jihadist networks not in the banlieue, suburbs, but in French prisons. A number of French jihadists do fit the young, Muslim, and angry profile. However, many, many French Muslims fit that description of young, angry, and disappointed without ever turning to terrorist violence. Most people have grievances. Only the marginal few join a terrorist organization. Psychological motivations vary. Moreover, the reasons people join a terrorist network may not be the same as those that motivate them to commit an act of terror. The suicide bomber may sign up hoping to become a martyr and to ascend directly to heaven, but when the moment comes to pull the trigger, there may simply be no opportunity for second thoughts. The Islamic State notoriously welded suicide bombers into the cars delivering the bombs so they could not escape. Along the road from novice to hardened fighter, PTSD, coercion, and indoctrination, often in the form of a choice between a death as a martyr or at the hands of comrades, or plain delusion, and any combination of these elements may set in. For these reasons, John Horgan, a criminal psychologist and political scientist, whose research spans ideological genres of terrorism, argues that we should ask how rather than why people become terrorists. Why? We cannot answer. Some fancy the excitement of fighting with a band of brothers. Some claim that they were directed to join by divine revelation. It is tricky, perhaps impossible, to generalize about psychological motivations. Terrorists often put the blame for bloodshed on the West. Violence did not originate from us. France and the USA started the killings. Once they stop, we'll stop. Personal conversion stories, however, typically cite a dream or divine intervention. I got stuck on the highway with no money, gas, or food. I was sick, and my wife was overwhelmed. Then an unknown man appears. He asked me to follow him. I looked back, and suddenly there were no cars. Don't ask me for an explanation. I have none. It was Allah. These are quotes from the account of a Frenchman named Rashid Qasim. Qasim became a high-level operative for the Islamic State. On behalf of the Islamic State, he directed by phone from the Caliphate the execution of a couple in a French suburb while their 2-year-old son looked on. He also provided instructions to 2 19-year-old Frenchmen who beheaded an 89-year-old priest in Normandy in 2016. Some recruits are simply enchanted with the utopian project. In 1993, a 25-year-old British Pakistani, Wazam Beg, who grew up in Birmingham, arrived in a training camp for the Mujahideen, the guerrillas who in the 1980s had fought against Soviet troops in Afghanistan. Years later, Beg described his experience in breathless tones. "The Afghan visit was a life-changing experience for me. No few days have ever affected me like that. I had met men who seemed to me exemplary in their faith and self-sacrifice, and seen a world that awed and inspired me." These statements do not support the supposition that the militants are attracted to the movement because they were angry, didn't fit in at home, or found doors closing in their faces. These are statements by people who are motivated by a vision, excitement, and a desire to be part of a new society. In any case, the social demography of the Western terrorists varies greatly from time to time and from country to country, down to the most typical age at which they join. Who becomes a terrorist depends in part on the job descriptions put out by the terrorist organizations. It is only recently, for example, that women were allowed to apply. The trend towards recruitment in prisons is in part due to the growing presences of jihadists in prisons, often serving long sentences. The United States has seen large numbers of converts join the ranks, whereas in France, comparatively few converts are recruited. Such differences may be explained by national differences between Western states with respect to their dealings with vulnerable population groups. It may also be, simply, that the recruiters work different levers, opportunistically, to bring people on board. Then there are those who think Islam is the problem. Gilles Capel, a French Arabist, argues that the real issue is the breakdown of authority in Islam. If Islam were better policed from within, we would not have a global problem with people like bin Laden running around pretending that they are authorized to pronounce religious rulings. In his book, The War for Muslim Minds, 2006, Capel argued that the problem at the heart of our predicament with Islamist extremism is a grand competition for religious control in Sunni Islam. Many Muslim religious leaders agree with Capel. The argument plays different ways. It is true that traditional Islam long ago made peace with the secular state. Abdullahi Ahmed Anahim, a professor of law at Emory University, argues that, historically, Islam has been pragmatic about accommodating Islamic religious law with the secular state, and would do well to be more accommodating to social change. The absence of a centralized high command in Islam has historically allowed local customs to blend in with the faith. But decentralization can also be a curse, because it allows sects and autocrats to chart out their own path. More recently, Kapel has sharpened his argument. The problem is to be found in a confrontation between good Islam and bad Islam. But now he argues that the origin of bad religion is not a matter of a lack of religious authority among those who know best. Rather, the blame rests with secular leftists. Bad Islam gained traction thanks to the French left's embrace of multiculturalism and its toleration of identity politics. Two kinds of protest movements have developed alongside each other, he argued. The left and the right operate as tactical frenemies in their confrontation with the secular state. The misbehavior of one party provides justifications for the other. Kapel's explanation appealed to neoconservatives who like to see extremism as the fault of left-wing multiculturalism. However, they generally ignored the fact that Kapel also blamed the French nationalists for the breakdown of Republican decorum. But Kapel's argument is inadequate because it limits itself to France. Jihadist extremism is not a French problem. It was, and is, a problem all over Europe. The recruitment networks that sent French men and women to the Islamic State, and the attack networks that are responsible for the many recent violent incidents, did not arise from multicultural coddling of extremist identity politics. Another school of thought about the roots of jihadist terrorism takes off from what is broadly called organization theory. I include under this rubric network theory, a general approach to understanding how things work that has broad applications in sociology, economics, and epidemiology. Organization theory draws on economic sociology, which developed in reaction to more abstract approaches in economics. Writing in 1937, Ronald Coase, an economist and a founding member of the organization theory school, memorably summed up this thinking. If a workman moves from Department Y to Department X, he does not go because of a change in relative prices, but because he is ordered to do so. Organization theory is focused on how human behavior is shaped by structures and contexts. The basic axioms are simple. Individuals make decisions contingent on what they know, what works for them, and how they may most efficiently obtain the result that they desire, at least in the short term. The bosses call the shots. The employees follow. Herbert Simon, another famous economist in this school and a Nobel Prize-winning economist, 1978, called its basic principle bounded rationality. Modern organization theory has gone through many updates since the works of the founding fathers. Interesting applications in the study of terrorism include Jacob N. Shapiro's book, The Terrorist's Dilemma, 2013, in which Shapiro argues that terrorist groups control their members in the same way as business leaders manage their organizations. Terrorist groups have leaders and followers, and the leaders tell the followers when and how to fight, and when to die. They are rule-driven organizations because ideology determines what is legitimate and what is not, where to hit, and where to refrain from direct attack. Another example of counterintuitive inferences following from this way of thinking is Alexander Gutfrin's theory of a sink line tipping point, where terrorist groups go into decline. To stay in business, a terrorist organization must grow, replace losses, and if possible, expand its ranks, while preserving core strategic objectives. Leaders face a dilemma. To stay true to the objectives and to recruit new members, terrorist bosses must order attacks. Attacks mean members will die or get caught by law enforcement agencies. In other words, to make business grow, the bosses must sacrifice members. If too many members are sacrificed and not enough new recruits are brought on board, the organization will sink. If the bosses protect members by ordering fewer attacks, and if they themselves seek out safe havens, the business will also suffer. Bruce Hoffman's evocative comparison of Al-Qaeda to a shark that must keep moving forward, no matter how slow or incrementally, or die, serves as an apt metaphor for the logic driving Al-Qaeda's business model. A number of different models have been proposed to describe the management structures of the transnational networks that linked Western followers to terrorist central command abroad. Miles Collar has argued that Al-Qaeda should be studied in the same way as criminologists study a transactional crime cartel. Like them, Al-Qaeda is in the business of transporting people, money, and contraband across borders. Other models range from control and command structures to self-managed, leaderless cells. The reality is that both types of cells may be observed. The efficient and consistent coordination of complex illegal operations across countries require a centralized command and control structure. For that purpose, a transnational networked organization can protect the bosses against exposure when things go wrong and arrests are made by placing operatives and bosses in different jurisdictions. Mimicking a social movement and spreading the word through the channels available in free societies, in contrast, better serve proselytizing and recruitment objectives. Surprisingly counterintuitive inferences follow. One is that terrorist organizations that operate in highly competitive markets are likely to be more violent than those that enjoy something approaching a local monopoly. Empirical evidence suggests this is broadly accurate. However, weaker organizations may also have to become more violent in order to attract support and new members. The primary purpose of violence is control, but it also works as propaganda and to recruit new followers. Controlling the message and the manpower has historically been important to the jihadist organizations. Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State could be remarkably bureaucratic. The plans drawn up for Al-Qaeda at the organization's founding meeting resembled a third-world government bureaucracy, with directorates for requisition and finances, employment contracts for foreign fighters stipulating their pay, and rest and recreation days off from combat, contingent on status, married, not married, and vouchers in lieu of monetary rewards, etc. The organization plan had more boxes in the diagram than there were people present at the meeting, and the sparseness of bin Laden's organization was such that it seemed unlikely that enough officers could be found to fill all the offices. Years later, Morten Storm, a Danish defector, complained that every time there were three people in a cell, one of them had to be appointed emir, the boss of the others. Storm joined the British Al-Mahajirun in the late 1990s and went to Yemen, where he became a soldier for Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, AQAP, the affiliate based in Yemen. There he encountered the same bureaucratic mindset. Storm himself became an undercover agent for Western intelligence in 2004. The Islamic State was similarly addicted to bureaucracy. leaks of intake interviews conducted by Islamic State managers in 2014 provided clues to a massively bureaucratic structure that underpinned the terrorist organization's control over the rank and file. One inference from these observations is that terrorist organizations may recruit much like organizations engaging in protest politics. They bring people on board, make them feel they are morally right, and make sure they develop thick personal relationships to fellow activists, and perhaps even marry into the movement. Another is that terrorism is not simply a means to an end, as Pape and other realists have argued. It is also the business that justifies the organization and keeps the leaders employed. It is a product used to sell the brand and recruit new members. The comparisons to crime syndicates and third world bureaucracies go only so far. When the terrorist organization needs to transfer resources, manpower, or capital, it is likely to operate in the crime syndicate mode. But crime syndicates want to stay hidden, and terrorists need to claim responsibility for criminal acts so as to advertise an agenda. Terrorism is a form for violent theater, as Brian M. Jenkins wrote years ago. Targets and methods are selected to convey a message. Terrorists need to brag about what they do. Violence is their product and their advertisement. They need to let the public know what they have done, or else they will not gain credit, which, after all, is what they want. A terrorist organization is a political proselytizing organization, a capital-raising entity, and a military organization all in one. In this book, I draw on modern organization theory, and in particular on network theory. Using empirical evidence, I will show that jihadist managers and operatives rely upon networked social contagion, mechanisms that involve friendship groups, propagandists, and locally based leaders to build their transnational organizations. And what brings people to the cause? My answer is networks. This is, of course, true of lots of things that happen in the course of a life. People get jobs through networks. They get married through networks. They join churches and go on pilgrimages through networks. In their book, Connected, 2009, Nicholas Christakis and James Fowler analyzed how networks determine behaviors and developed what they call the 3 degrees of influence rule, which holds that influence networks work through your friends, first degree, the friends of friends, second degree, and the friends' friends' friends, third degree. Ideas spread through networks. Innovation does too. Studying civil rights activists who had risked life and imprisonment by engaging in civil disobedience in 1964, the sociologist Douglas McAdam concluded that simply knowing someone who was already engaged in the movement made recruitment to this high-risk political activity much more likely. Today, a person, certainly a young person, is likely to catch an idea through online social networks. But terrorism does not stay online. It happens offline, in real-life collaborations and networks. Network theory suggests a simple hypothesis. To become a terrorist, you first have to know one. Norms, contacts, and opportunities flow through networks. Individuals belonging to the same network tend to see themselves as socially similar, and they are therefore predisposed to find value in the same ideas and behaviors. The social contagion mechanisms by means of which jihadist radicalization is transmitted are not very different from those that lead people to become anti-federalists or to join cults and other high-risk adversarial belief communities. Empirical studies, some of which will be discussed in detail later in the book, support an understanding of radicalization as a psychosocial process that involves reinforcement by peers and communities. Networks are often thought of as a good thing. Robert Putnam's book, Bowling Alone, 2002, presented the decline of interpersonal social networks as the cause of social disengagement and decline. The book did much to represent social networks in a rosy glow. Putnam said, "Networks build social capital, a civic investment in societal investment and growth." 20 years later, a tectonic shift brought along by online media has people thinking differently about the benefits of networking. Social capital has many guises, and not all are for the good of society or for the individual caught up in them. Victor Assall, a political scientist, describes dark networks as social capital gone wrong and utilized for evil purposes. Thick social networks, which rely on family ties, kinship, and peer groups to build cohesion and control, may support investment and progress and civic and economic development, but they can also confine their members in a social prison or be mobilized for illicit purpose. Social contagion models have been used to study the spread of public health problems, such as obesity and smoking, and also to study opinion formation and the spread of innovations. Social contagion through networks, online or offline, whether based on geographical or cultural proximity, peer groups or self-chosen identities, is a well-established way to describe and explain the spread of a range of behaviors in public health, economics, and sociology and political science. Herbert Bloomer, a sociologist whose work on social contagion was inspired by the turbulence of the 1930s, regarded social contagion as central to a broad range of group behaviors that individuals would not undertake under normal circumstances. For example, crowds, mobs, panics, manias, dancing crazes, stampedes, mass behavior, public opinion, propaganda, fashion, fads, social movements, revolutions, and reforms. Violent extremism fits right in. In epidemiology, contagion is the mechanism through which diseases are spread by direct contact between a sick and a healthy person. This is contact, or simple contagion. The coronavirus pandemic has made this type of contagion familiar to everybody. Catching an idea or a behavior from another person is obviously a different matter. It involves volition, opportunity, and access. The individual has to be receptive to the ideas. And to execute the program of action, there must be an organization of fellow believers capable of providing direction and reinforcement. It is more accurate to identify facilitated complex social contagion as the mechanism by which extremism grows. It is facilitated because savvy operators can manipulate a recruitment network to promote contagion. Complex rather than simple contagion is involved because social reinforcement is required. A person is more likely to join a group holding particular views if he or she has affirmative connections with others who subscribe to the same ideas. Network theory is a methodology that provides a way of analyzing social structures. But network structures themselves tend to produce certain outcomes simply because of the way in which they are built to work. They are relatively durable and compelling instruments for resource mobilization and organization. Taking network structures as explanations of social action is an example of what Robert Merton described as middle-range theories, theories that can guide empirical inquiry and are intermediate to general theories of social systems, which are too remote from particular classes of social behavior, organization, and change. Organization of the book. The book is organized chronologically. roughly three cycles of expansion, collapse, and regeneration can be identified in the evolution of Al-Qaeda. Each cycle produced distinct waves of new mobilization of Western followers. The organization of the chapters in this book follows a chronology of mobilization cycles that have driven the expansion of the Western branches of the global jihadist movement. Figure 1.1 depicts the rising number of followers in Western countries between 1992 and 2018. The three curves chart the number of verified arrests, deaths, and the first attempts to go abroad as a foreign fighter by year. The methodological appendix explains the coding protocol. The number of new Western recruits traveling abroad to join jihadist groups and training camps had started to rise before the 9/11 attacks in 2001. Recruitment increased again in the aftermath of the attacks. After a brief dip in 2002, attributable to the closure of the camps in Afghanistan, the activity level picked up again. The 9/11 attacks did not deter Westerners from signing up for bin Laden's project. Decade by decade, the steady-state numbers of first-time offenders have ratcheted up. The prevalence of domestic arrests, and with some delay, also deaths, increased sharply in 2013 and 2014. The increase in both measures are attributable to the mobilization wave associated with the rise of the Islamic State. Chapter 2 focuses on bin Laden's education and myth-making, and presents a novel account of his own trajectory to extremism and personal attachments to the West, and to Britain in particular. Chapter 3 is focused on bin Laden's role in the 1993 World Trade Center attack and the development of Al-Qaeda's bases in the United States. The chapter describes the importance of bin Laden's alliance with two Egyptian terrorist groups in exile, one headed by al-Zawahiri and the other by Omar Abdelrahman, the blind sheikh in Brooklyn. Chapter 4 deals with bin Laden's years in Sudan, 1991 to 1996. These are sometimes seen as a hiatus, a time when bin Laden was between jobs. This is not accurate. It was from Sudan that he began funding bridgeheads in Europe and in the United States, worked with his Egyptian associates to plan and manage the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center in Lower Manhattan, initiated the plans that resulted in the 1998 bombings of the U.S. embassies in Tanzania and Kenya, and took the first steps leading to the 9/11 strike. Chapter 5 is about Al-Qaeda's London office and bin Laden's takeover of the North African jihadist groups. Chapter 6 presents an account of the 9/11 attacks and the aftermath, the counterstrike by the United States that nearly crushed Al-Qaeda. The second part of the book traces the movement's recovery after the 9/11 attacks and the emergence of what came to be described as homegrown terrorism. The wave was long thought to be the work of leaderless cells of alienated young Muslim descendants of immigrants to Western European countries. Today, the consensus is that bin Laden was directly involved in the planning of the Madrid train bombings, 2004, and oversaw the planning of the London bombings, 2005, while in hiding. Computer files seized during the raid on bin Laden's compound in Abbottabad, Pakistan, on May 2, 2011, showed that bin Laden had been involved, as a U.S. official said, in directing every recent major Al-Qaeda attack against the West. Michael Morell, the CIA deputy director at the time, writes in his autobiography that the agency had been surprised to learn that bin Laden had been micromanaging the organization and was intimately involved in attack planning. My research shows, however, that neither story is entirely accurate. Bin Laden was not sidelined, but neither was he omnipresent. Action scripts provided by the ideology and the social structure of the organization gave leadership and coordination. Chapter 7 describes the integration of the Western cells with al-Qaeda's command structure during the years of what became known as homegrown terrorism and produced the train bombings in Madrid, 2004, and in London, 2005, and many more less-known terrorist events. Chapter 8 explains some core concepts in the jihadist belief system, as they were understood by a veteran Danish-Algerian foreign fighter who spent several years in Guantanamo Bay detention camp, Gitmo. He died fighting for the al-Nusra Front, an al-Qaeda affiliate in Syria. A demographic picture of the American jihadists and their roles in the global organization as propagandists and webmasters is presented in Chapter 9. Chapter 10 is an in-depth study of the two brothers responsible for the Boston Marathon bombings in 2013. The third part of the book tracks the recruitment tactics that fueled the wave of migration to the Islamic State, and which radically changed the demographics of a new generation of Western militants. Chapter 11 analyzes the roles played by the Western recruits in the jihadist movement, as leaders and as grunts. The last chapter, Chapter 12, looks to the future. The structural factors that have driven jihadist regeneration in the past are intact. They are even being revitalized, and they include more people in more places than ever before. As this book goes to print, we are in a lull. A decline in arrest and incidents that began in 2018 has continued. In 2020, the global pandemic shut down international travel. Terrorists fear the virus, too. Travel opportunities are more restricted and more strictly monitored. There are still regular arrests and prosecutions and lone attacker incidents. Europol reported a total of 436 individuals arrested on suspicion of jihadist terrorist offenses in 2019. EU citizens accounted for 242 of those arrested. Over half of the attacks were committed by citizens in their own countries. 10 people died in 2019 as a result of terrorist incidents. The number of incidents attributed to right-wing extremists grew significantly in the same period, but all deaths in the European Union that were due to terrorism resulted from jihadist actions. Whatever and whenever al-Qaeda is perceived to suffer a setback, there is talk that al-Qaeda is at last on its way out. In his book, The Rise and Fall of al-Qaeda, 2011, Fawaz Gurges argued that U.S. government narratives have allowed a ragtag guerrilla force to portray themselves as legitimate Muslim warriors. Worse, excessive counterterrorism policies alienated Muslims and gifted the extremists a large audience. Shortly after Gurges's book was published, al-Zawahiri sent veteran al-Qaeda men to eastern Syria to set up a fighter group. By December, the first wave of veteran fighters from Europe made their way to join Jabhat al-Nusra, al-Qaeda's newest organization, which was officially launched in January 2012. 2 years later, the new caliphate controlled a geographic area the size of the United Kingdom, and Britons had filmed themselves committing crimes against humanity that they uploaded to YouTube and Twitter. Excessive counterterrorism causing alienation can hardly be faulted for the wave of new recruits to the global jihadist movement that followed. The United States sat on its hands for 3 years. Muslim parents were enraged that their governments did so little to stop the migration. In 2017, Daniel Byman likened al-Qaeda to social media companies like Friendster or MySpace that initially succeeded and pioneered many important techniques, but eventually saw competitors reap the benefits. Byman does not think jihadist terrorism is a shadow on the wall, conjured up to grow military budgets. But he argues that we should accept that al-Qaeda itself is yesterday's news, and instead focus on the other organizations in the global movement that al-Qaeda fostered. He identified the 2005 London bombings as al-Qaeda's last successful mass casualty attack in Europe. However, further attacks have since been carried out by al-Qaeda affiliates, and recently by al-Qaeda's rival, the Islamic State. The fact is that the affiliates are al-Qaeda. AQAP, the branch organization based in Yemen, was deputized to attack the West in the name of al-Qaeda, in part because it had excellent outreach to Western militants and travelers with passports that could get them on flights heading to the United States. It is also not correct that al-Qaeda Central ceased terrorist operations against the West after 2005. In 2008, al-Qaeda took responsibility for the bombing of the Danish embassy in Pakistan to punish the country for allowing a newspaper to publish cartoons of Muhammad. Al-Qaeda also laid plans to kidnap and execute the editorial staff of the newspaper that published the infamous cartoons. Ilyash Kashmiri, a veteran operative who worked for both al-Qaeda and Mullah Omar's Taliban, deputized the operational planning of the plot to David Coleman Headley, a Pakistani-American who traveled twice to Denmark to scout out the targets. Headley went so far as to walk into the newspaper's building in Copenhagen, where he pretended to want to place an ad. The plot was modeled on the November 2008 assault in Mumbai, for which Headley also did the pre-attack scouting. He was sentenced to 35 years in prison in 2013 after a trial in U.S. federal court in Chicago. In 2009, simultaneous attacks in New York City and in Manchester were foiled. The master planner was Adnan Shukri Juma, an American from Florida, who joined al-Qaeda around the time of the 9/11 attacks. The coordinated strikes were supposed to be another signature al-Qaeda operation. It was foiled and forgotten, and is left off the list. In 2010, al-Qaeda took responsibility for a bombing of a German bakery in Mumbai, India. The civil war in Syria was an interlude, a tactical retreat by al-Qaeda from its campaign against the far enemy. The hiatus ended on December 6, 2019, when a Saudi cadet on a military exchange program, Mohammed Saeed Al-Shamrani, shot and killed three U.S. sailors inside a classroom on a U.S. naval base in Pensacola, Florida. 4 months later, the government accessed his iPhone and discovered that Al-Shamrani had been in touch with handlers from al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, AQAP, before the attack and for years before he arrived in the United States. It was an insider attack, conducted in the signature style of AQAP. Al-Shamrani had been radicalized as early as 2015. He was directed by his handlers in AQAP to join the Royal Saudi Air Force, and with that cover, to undertake a terrorist mission in the United States. The objective of the mission was, as always, to compel the United States to withdraw from collaboration with the near enemy, Saudi Arabia. Initially, the reaction was the one the terrorists hoped for. In the aftermath of the shooting, the Pentagon reacted by suspending all operational training for 900 Saudi military students on American bases. A stricter vetting program was also announced for an estimated 5,200 Saudi Arabian students in the United States, making it more difficult for Saudis to study at American universities. This book provides little support for the declinist thesis that al-Qaeda is over, nor does it support the notion that crude and badly targeted counterterrorism policies are counterproductive and end up providing al-Qaeda and ISIS with newly alienated followers. These arguments misconstrue both why and how people living in Western societies end up joining the global jihadist movement. They also tend to understate the threat the jihadists posed to American interests. the migration of thousands of foreign fighters to join jihadist groups in the Syrian civil war mobilized the Western bases and brought many new recruits to the global struggle. Not only did the movement grow in size, it also diffused across the map and set up footholds in small and mid-sized cities across North America and Western Europe and further afield. A new cadre of trained operatives and professional fighters with military training was created. So the underlying structural factors that have historically allowed al-Qaeda and the global jihadist movement to regenerate are still in place. Outposts and networks are still there, with the potential to support fresh strikes. 2. The Founder. On May 2, 2011, Osama bin Laden was killed by a unit of the U.S. Navy's Special Forces, known as SEAL Team 6. Years of detective work had led the CIA to the house in Pakistan, where bin Laden had been hiding for 5 years with three of his wives, his children, and grandchildren. Four other people were killed in the raid. Bin Laden's adult son, Khalid, two brothers who had acted as housekeepers, and one of their wives. When they departed, the SEALs carried away bin Laden's body. The next day, he was buried in the Arabian Sea, dropped overboard from a Navy ship. The SEALs also took with them papers and the hard drives from computers found in the house, and they made an inventory of bin Laden's library. This Abbottabad horde led the intelligence community to revise their assessment of bin Laden's role during his years in hiding. Conventional wisdom had it that his deputy, Ayman al-Zawahiri, rather than bin Laden, had been running the organization. That view was now revised. Bin Laden's correspondence showed that he had been in constant, if irregular, correspondence with al-Zawahiri and other members of the top command, and that he was directly involved in the planning of attacks on the West. Michael Morell, deputy director of the Central Intelligence Agency, CIA, at the time of the raid, later wrote that bin Laden had been issuing orders and micromanaging the organization from his hideaway, approving personnel appointments, approving how money was spent, and intimately involved in attack planning. My aim in this chapter is to provide a correction to simplistic views of bin Laden as a man in a cave, a throwback to a different age coming back to haunt the West. Files from the cache taken from the house in Abbottabad have been translated, and they can now be found on a website titled Bin Laden's Bookshelf, maintained by the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, ODNI. More documents were released by the CIA and posted online. Documents are also available in Arabic and in translation on the website for the Harmony Project archives of the West Point Combating Terrorism Center. The cache of documents not only revealed bin Laden's ongoing leadership role, they also provided new insights into his thinking. The compound had no internet connection, but bin Laden had books and reports written by American academics brought in by the couriers who kept him connected to the world. Copies of some of these books are also on my bookshelves. He followed the news and persuaded himself that the financial crisis of 2008 was a harbinger of the end of Western imperialism. In October 2010, 6 months before his death, bin Laden wrote to a trusted associate, "They struck us, and we will strike them back. Anyone who looks at the enemies in NATO, especially America, will know that they are in big trouble. This year has been the worst year for them in Afghanistan since they invaded it. The number of their dead has never been this high, according to their own reports. Their financial crisis continues. Britain has lowered its defense budget, and America is reducing the budget of the Pentagon." He continued, "Anyone who knows the world and knows politics knows that it is impossible for them to continue with the war. There is no difference between them and the Soviet Union before it withdrew from Afghanistan. Bin Laden's view that the United States would collapse on its own from the strain of fighting the righteous troops under his command was formed in 1989 when he mistakenly concluded that the Mujahideen in Afghanistan had brought the Soviet Union to its collapse. 20 years on, he held fast to the theory. Other new sources have emerged in recent years that provide intimate, often surprising insights into Bin Laden's life and more private behaviors. Family members, former associates, undercover agents, and employees who turned against him, including one of his bodyguards, have published books. An extraordinary book, The Exile, 2017, by Kathy Scott Clark and Adrian Levy, tells the story of what happened after Bin Laden, his family, and close associates survived the military assault on al-Qaeda's bases in Afghanistan after the 9/11 attacks. Bin Laden and some of his family went to northwest Pakistan, where friendly jihadist groups took them in. One of his wives, six of his children, and 11 of his grandchildren ended up in house arrest in Iran. The book is based, in part, on conversations with Abu Hafs al-Muritani. The name is an alias for Mahfouz Walid al-Walid, who was confined to house arrest in Iran for more than a decade after the flight from Afghanistan, and on interviews with the wives and members of their families. Few declassified government sources or other archives cover this period, so the book is more valuable for that reason. The accounts are not always reliable or consistent. There is also inevitably an element of self-censorship, since the authors are reluctant to say anything that might cause them to end up in American court. Even so, a picture emerges of Bin Laden as a man who was obsessed with his role in history. Life in hiding was a strain. Some of his sons left and went back to Saudi Arabia. Others were killed. Two wives left him. Family life was strained by quarrels between the wives, and his efforts to control his sprawling family were not entirely successful. Scattered in the stories are also suggestions about personal cowardice and errors in judgment stemming from his delusional visions of the inevitable downfall of America at the hands of the jihadists. All in all, the new sources yield a more nuanced and reliable account of Bin Laden's personal experiences with Western society that shows how he carefully curated his image to become an iconic figure for a deeply anti-Western religious movement. The Education of Osama Bin Laden. Osama Bin Laden was born in 1957 in Riyadh, the only child of Mohammed bin Laden's 10th wife, A'aliya Khanum. She is now known as Hamida al-Atz after her second husband. When Osama was 2, his parents divorced. The reasons for the divorce are not known, but Bin Laden Sr. married and divorced more than 20 times in his lifetime. It may be that Osama's mother was not meant to be a permanent wife. After the divorce, she was conveniently married off to an employee in the Bin Laden family corporation. The convention in traditional Muslim societies is that in the event of divorce, young children follow their mother, rejoining the father upon reaching puberty. The young Osama accordingly went to live with his mother and her second husband, and was integrated into her family. The men in the family were monogamous. The women dressed in the Western style. Summers were spent with the mother's family in Latakia, Syria, an ancient city with a mixed population of Christians and Shia and Sunni Muslims. The Assad family that controls Syria today comes from the same area. The Assads are Alawites, a Shia sect, and it has been suggested that Bin Laden's mother was an Alawite. Mixed marriages between Sunni and Shia Muslims were not uncommon in the region in those days. Mohammed bin Laden made a fortune modernizing the highways of Saudi Arabia and building homes for members of the royal family. He died in an airplane accident when Osama was 10. Allegedly, Osama had only once spoken directly with his father, and father and son had met in person only 5 times. After the death of the patriarch, the firstborn son, Salim bin Laden, took over the management of the corporation. Still only in his 20s, Salim was a cosmopolitan, pleasure-loving young man. He had attended an English boarding school and married an English woman. He and his young brothers, sisters, and cousins were frequent visitors to London. In his book, The Bin Ladens, Steve Call describes Salim bin Laden's excursions to California and Las Vegas, where he gambled and drank alcohol, forbidden activities according to Islam, and certainly prohibited by the Wahhabi theology. He also had American girlfriends. Following the rules at home and ignoring them when out of the country is nothing new. It wasn't that Salim and the other bin Ladens were not religious. They just practiced Islam in the relaxed manner that was common among the elite throughout the region in the 1970s. Bin Laden Sr. emphasized the importance of an English education for his children, and his wishes would have been attended to after his death. His sons were sent to boarding schools in Lebanon. The favored eldest sons, who were destined to inherit the management of the sprawling business, went on to schools in the United Kingdom. Some of their sisters also attended English-language boarding schools. Osama himself was a boarder at a Quaker-run English-language school in Beirut, but not for long. A dozen of bin Laden's half-brothers, even a half-sister, went on to study at universities in the United States. After the school in Beirut, Osama was enrolled in an elite secular high school in Jeddah that taught a curriculum stressing science. Osama had more direct experience of the West than has been thought by his detractors and admirers alike. When he was 13, he traveled to the United Kingdom for medical treatment. It is not known what he was treated for. The following year, he attended a language course in London and spent weekends in Oxford and in Shakespeare's hometown, Stratford-on-Avon. Abdul Bari Atwan, a London-based Palestinian journalist and editor of Al-Quds Al-Arabi, has written about this trip and bin Laden's other trips to London. Stories about bin Laden's travel to Europe have been a matter of controversy due to the assertion that he was radicalized as a teen by his revulsion against Western immorality. Among the discoveries in Abbottabad was a personal journal that bin Laden was writing at the time of his death. The journal included reminiscences of his London trips as a teenager. The first time I went to the West was during a sixth-grade vacation in 89 Hijri, 69 AD, 1970. I was 13 to receive a treatment, he wrote. In the following year, I went in the summer to Britain and stayed there for approximately 2.5 months. The following year, I felt that I shouldn't go, and I realized that a committed person doesn't go to the West, and I refused to go. My impression was that they are loose people, and my age did not allow me to paint, to see, a full picture of their lives. Every Sunday we go to visit, present tense used in the original, the House of Shakespeare. We saw that it is a society different than our society, and it is morally decayed. The journal reads like a draft of an autobiography written with an eye on posterity. It is not entirely honest. Bin Laden did, in fact, return to London later in life, and in the early 1990s, he even considered moving there. After the 9/11 attacks, a Swedish newspaper dug up an old story about a visit by bin Laden to the country in the early 1970s. A teenager, Osama allegedly traveled with a group of half-siblings led by the eldest brother, Salim. Salim himself had first visited Sweden in 1969 to sign a contract for the purchase of 200 trucks from Volvo in Gothenburg. During the visit, the locals took the young Saudi to the hippest discotheque in the area, which was in Fallon, a small town nearby, and Salim made friends with the owners of the discotheque. He subsequently made several visits to Sweden. Once, in 1971, combining business with pleasure, he flew a party of siblings to Copenhagen and then drove them up to Fallon. A photograph of the traveling party of 23 bin Laden siblings appeared in the local newspaper. They are standing in front of a Cadillac parked on the town's main street. A national Swedish newspaper, Aftonbladet, republished the photo in 2001 after the 9/11 attacks. The paper went back to Fallon and interviewed local people about their memories of visits from the bin Laden family. Among those interviewed was the housekeeper of the hotel where the party stayed. She and other locals were certain that Osama had been part of the group. Osama was identified as the young teenager standing in the middle row, number two from the right. The gaggle of young family members is dressed in the contemporary style of young people in Europe and the United States. The men grew their hair long, and they are all wearing tight turtleneck sweaters and bell-bottom pants in the style of the time. None of the women are covering their hair or their faces, and they wear the same style of pants the men wear. The picture was reprinted in 2001 in several British and European papers, but curiously, the reprint showed the family wearing garishly colored clothes. The original photograph was in black and white. In the early 1970s, newspapers did not print color photos. Color was added to the reprints in a newspaper office somewhere. The photo reprinted here is the original version. Doubts have been raised about the identification of Osama in the photo. Stephen Call concluded that despite the insistence of the Swedish hosts, Osama did not come along on that trip to Sweden. Call's source is Carmen bin Laden, the divorced sister-in-law of one of Osama's half-brothers. She was adamant that Osama had not been part of the trip. She also told Call that Osama went abroad only three times, once as a 10-year-old with his mother for medical treatment in London, once with the family on safari in East Africa, and once with his first wife to the United States. However, as bin Laden's entries to his journal show, Carmen was mistaken about the young Osama's travels. She may also have been wrong about the trip to Sweden. She married into the family only in 1974, after the trip. According to Lawrence Wright, Osama had a religious awakening when he was 14, around the time of his language course in London. Wright's source is an interview with his mother, Aalia Ghanem, that appeared in the Mail on Sunday, a British tabloid, after the 9/11 attacks. But Osama was not living with his mother at the time of the alleged moral awakening. He was by then based in his father's household and was away most of the time at boarding school, so there may be doubts about how much his mother knew about what he was up to. Bin Laden's mother has given a number of interviews to journalists, always insisting that it was exposure to the wicked West that caused bin Laden to become an enemy of America and its allies. Her reliability as a character witness suffered a blow, however, when in 2018 she told a journalist from The Guardian that bin Laden was a very good kid and he loved me so much. She complained that her life had been difficult because her son had been unable to see her for so long. She neglected to mention that the reason why mother and son could not meet was that her good kid was a wanted terrorist. Also misleadingly, but perhaps understandably, Aalia Ghanem described herself as being in her mid-70s. She was born in 1934 and was, in fact, 84 at the time of the interview. The London conversion story has all the hallmarks of a life rewritten to suit a preferred narrative. The alleged moral awakening puts the young Osama in a sweet spot of jihadist narratives about the conversion experience. His alleged embrace of righteousness as a young teen is situated at that crucial point when boys assume the responsibility of adulthood and are considered ready to accept the armed jihad as an individual religious duty, Fard Alin. Stories of questionable authenticity about revelations and suddenly hearing the call to jihad are routine in the autobiographies of jihadist warriors who put great value on sinners' conversion stories and divine interventions. In his journal, bin Laden was also not entirely truthful about the intellectual influences of his teachers. He writes that the first time he thought about jihad was in high school, and stressed that he came to the realization that jihad was required without outside guidance. Specifically, he claimed that the Muslim Brothers did not influence him. In fact, Lawrence Wright writes, a gym teacher at the Al-Fagher High School in Jeddah introduced bin Laden to the ideas associated with the Muslim Brotherhood when he was still a young teenager. This disavowal of any influence from the Brotherhood suits the requirements of jihadist political correctness, according to which the Brotherhood is an ideological arch-enemy. Was bin Laden along on the trip to Sweden? Did he become radicalized on his trips to London as a teenager? Does it matter? Retrieving the original story from the archives, I found no mention of Osama's name in the local paper. But then, there is also no reason his name should be recorded. The only individual who was identified by name was Salem, the businessman in charge. Osama was one of the youngest and least significant members of the family group. By 2001, when the story broke about bin Laden's masterminding of the attacks in New York and Washington, D.C., it is possible the Swedish witnesses may have been too quick to say, yes, he was here. That the world's most wanted terrorists had come for a visit is a juicy story. The Swedes might also have had difficulty telling the young Saudis apart. The teenage males in the photo all have a strong family resemblance. The youth identified as Osama could have been a different brother. I went looking for photographs. The clues are few, but the teenager in the Swedish photo identified as Osama resembles a photograph taken 2 years later that was included in the bin Laden family photo collection. This photo is published in a memoir his wife and one of his sons wrote of their lives with bin Laden. In that case, we know for sure this is a photo of Osama. The date of the visit to Sweden also roughly corresponds to when he is known to have attended language school in the United Kingdom. Those clues make it plausible, at least, that Osama was in the photo from Sweden. A Spanish classmate in the language course in London the same year as the one from Fallon took another picture of Osama, this one from 1971. It appeared in a Spanish paper in October 2001. The young man identified as Osama by his fellow student, she is in the picture too, is unmistakably the same as the youngster shown in the picture from Fallon. In that picture, Osama and two of his older half-brothers stand with their arms around two smartly dressed Spanish girls in a park in Oxford. The girls were classmates in the language course. 30 years later, one of the girls in the photo gave the picture to the paper El Correo. Listeners can follow the reference and go to the newspaper's site where the article is still available. Other photos produced by the classmate showed Osama and his fellow students, including the Spanish girls, having a picnic, and Osama punting a boat on the Charwell in Oxford. All in all, it is probable that the photo of the bin Laden siblings in Sweden does actually include Osama. It matters only because between those keen to depict bin Laden as a freak from the Saudi Arabian desert and bin Laden's own efforts to say he abhorred the West from a young age, it becomes important to point out that bin Laden was far more normal for his age and his social class than is assumed most of the time. The Spanish woman who provided the photos from Oxford requested anonymity, but the journalists who saw the photos verified her story. Notes scribbled on the back of her pictures from the time in the United Kingdom identified the people in the photos. Younger listeners may find this peculiar, but in 1971, people took photos with cameras rather than cell phones. When the film was developed after the trip abroad, you wrote on the back to remind you of who was in the photo and where it was taken, and you then put the photos in albums. The owner of the photos, who is also in the photos with the young bin Laden, reported that the 14-year-old Osama did not seem put out by the immodest clothes of the young women. Nor was he particularly interested in politics or overly religious. She volunteered also that Osama was not a fan of the hectic London scene, and that he appeared to be sad about his family affairs. Osama allegedly told fellow language students that he and his brothers had different mothers, and that his mother had been a concubine. Was the mother really a concubine? Bin Laden Sr. never married Osama's mother in a proper Quranic ceremony. Whatever the truth about the concubine claim, it is part of Saudi lore about why bin Laden went bad. In an interview with CNN in 2001, a Saudi journalist, Ali Abbas al-Ahmad, insisted that Osama bin Laden's mother was never properly married to his father, repeating the claim twice for emphasis. She was not a wife. She was not a wife. It is hard to know what to make of this. Saudi storytelling about bin Laden often attempts to erase him from the fabric of proper Saudi society. It is evident that bin Laden treated his mother respectfully, even lovingly, throughout his life, but his mother's status may have been a painful issue for him. The family drama is relevant to the story of how bin Laden became a world leader of a deadly terrorist organization. Recent research on the drivers of radicalization has identified family-related trauma as a risk factor. This may range from lacking male role models at home to sudden shocks associated with divorce or the loss of a parent. Combine such background factors with personality factors that include a desire to be somebody or do something, and given a push from alternative father figures and peer groups, a pathway may open up, leading to rebellion against family and society norms, and in some cases, to extremist activism. Osama's home life was highly unusual, but his marginalized status in the hyper-wealthy bin Laden family figures and his evident desire to acquire big man status make him a typical candidate for a teenage rebellion against family and Saudi society. Add in his wealth and the status that gave him in the small world of the global jihad. Bin Laden had the intelligence, some but not too much, the sufficiently narcissistic personality, the business acumen, and the belief system to become a leader in the movement. Bin Laden married for the first time in 1974. He was still a teenager. The groom was 17 and the bride 15. They were first cousins. The father of the bride was the brother of Osama's mother. Convention would have dictated that he marry a cousin on his father's side of the family, but Osama may have been considered a marginal member of the clan, and therefore did not warrant a marriage with a paternal cousin. Bin Laden traveled widely after his marriage. It has been suggested that both before and after this marriage, Osama engaged in drinking, gambling, and womanizing while on regular visits with his half-brothers to Beirut and to Western cities. Family accounts confirm bin Laden's early and enduring love for sports cars, speeding, and fast horses. His first wife, Najwa, writes about an incident when the young couple was visiting the family in Latakia, the coastal Syrian city that was home to the mother's side of her husband's family. Bin Laden was stopped for speeding. He got the ticket fixed. The stories about debauchery may be false and are probably at least overblown. In any case, if bin Laden was cavorting in Beirut, as the rumors would have it, his behavior would have been no different from that of his father and other young wealthy Saudi men at the time. The stories may have been put about later to discredit bin Laden, but if so, they misfired. A history of sinning would not have been damaging to bin Laden's reputation. Sinning and moral awakening are conventional pivot points in jihadist autobiographies. Once the hero sees the light and embraces the obligation to conduct jihad, the sins of the past are forgiven. Bin Laden came of age as everything around him was rapidly changing. The Middle East was becoming newly rich and outward-looking. In the 1970s, great cultural and intellectual changes came even in Saudi Arabia, the most conservative society in the Middle East. During the 1973 Arab-Israeli War, Arab members of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, imposed an embargo against the United States and a number of other Western countries as a reprisal for their support of Israel. The OPEC cartel triggered booming oil prices, and there was a sudden and vast accumulation of oil revenues in the Gulf states. The bin Laden family prospered. Like most wealthy families in the oil-rich Arab states, they aspired to Western education, shopping, and international travel. But at the same time, new cracks appeared in the conservative kingdoms. The region was on the front line during the tug of war between revolutionaries of Marxist and Islamist orientations. Listeners wanting a first-hand account of the cross-currents of money and politics in the 1970s may turn to Kai Bird's terrific account of the life and death of Robert Ames, a swashbuckling American spy in the Middle East, which provides a thrilling version of the freewheeling Western lifestyles that soon would be challenged by Islamist revolutionaries. The turning point in bin Laden's life came when he was exposed to Egyptian Islamist radicals in Jeddah. In 1976, he started studying business management at King Abdul Aziz University in Jeddah. Now a father of three, he also worked in the family construction company. While studying in Jeddah, bin Laden became a disciple of a Palestinian refugee, Abdullah Yusuf Azam, the man known as the father of the global jihad. Steve Call, who interviewed bin Laden's classmates and friends, writes that bin Laden started to read Azam's writings during his student days in Jeddah. He was also studying other key Islamist revolutionary texts, including books by Sayyid Qutb and by Qutb's brother, Muhammad Qutb, who was also one of bin Laden's teachers. Sayyid Qutb is a foundational figure in Islamist political thought, and his ideas influenced the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood. He was executed in 1966 in Egypt during a crackdown on the Brotherhood. Bin Laden was also reading the works of the 13th-century warrior theologian Ibn Taymiyyah, 1263-1328, a legendary figure in jihadist history, writing, and political theory. Bin Laden's later proclamations and sermons are full of references to Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah's writings and personal biography of itinerant opposition to the Muslim rulers of the time suit the jihadists. He was imprisoned on account of his calls for jihad against the Mongol Empire, which was held to be responsible for the conquest of Muslim territory in the 13th and 14th centuries. The Mongols converted to Islam and made Islam the state religion in most of the empire, but they were not regarded as true Muslims by Arab Muslims. Jihadism works on the basis of parallel thinking and historical analogies. Ibn Taymiyyah's account of the Mughal occupation of the true Muslim heartland is now an analogous narrative device used by the jihadists and by bin Laden to justify the call for armed jihad against devious Muslim tyrants and the West. Azam, bin Laden's mentor, was a towering figure in the jihadist movement. In the mid-1970s, he was expelled from Jordan, where he had been teaching, and moved to Saudi Arabia. He began his political career in the Palestine Liberation Organization, PLO, but did not follow the organization's shift in the early 1970s towards Marxist liberation theory and its embrace by the communist bloc. Azam instead went to the Al-Azhar University in Cairo, graduating with a Ph.D. in Quranic studies. An itinerant radical, he ended up in Saudi Arabia, which at that time was welcoming Muslim Brotherhood figures. Today, the jihadist movement venerates Azam for his intellectual contribution and also for his role as a military commander in Afghanistan. It is probable that Azam and bin Laden first met in Jeddah. What is known for sure is that in 1979, bin Laden met Azam in the United States. Najwa writes that she recognized Azam from pictures as the man her husband met with during their visit. Azam was touring American mosques, raising money for the jihad against the communists in Afghanistan. Bin Laden's wife, Najwa, and the children stayed with acquaintances in Indiana during the trip to the United States, which may have been undertaken to see.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.